The previous question alluded to Catholicism as a variant of Christianity and the difference between Christianity and Islam. I'm interested in finding out more about the variants within Islam, the different sects. I only know the names of a few of them, Shiite and Sunni, for example. Can you briefly tell me the difference between the major sects within Islam and which one of those, if any, predominates within the UAE?
What are the major sects in Islam? And the two famous are the Sunni and the Shia.
Well, let's say that there is basically one Islam. 90% of Muslims belong to one Islam. The label used Sunni Islam to distinguish it from Shi'i or Shiite Islam, found mostly in Iran, Iraq, Syria, concentrated in these areas. They represent a splinter from the main body. They share the same Quran, the same pillars of faith, but they have put stress on certain individuals who they refer to as the imams. And these have become intermediaries between themselves and God. They pray through them to God and things like this. Whereas the main body holds that you pray directly to God with no intermediation, etc. You know, so we could say probably Shiism is closer to Catholicism, you know, in that sense of intermediation. And I mean, from the in the Shiite camp, there are a variety of also subgroups that have also appeared, you know, historically. The other separations that you might hear, so we could say Dubai, the Emirates, is basically Sunni. There are Shiites here, there are Shiite mosques, etc. here. But amongst the Sunni, you may hear of four main groups. These are not sects, these are schools of law. The Maliki school, the Shafi'i school, the Hanbali school, and the Hanafi school. The school followed here mainly, and this is in the courts, is the Maliki school, you know, in Dubai and in Abu Dhabi. And these are, as I said, these are just legal interpretations of law. These wouldn't be considered to be sects.
Just like Protestant and Catholic, I think so.
Protestant and Catholic, it goes back to fundamental belief in systems. It's a bit bigger. The difference is a bit bigger. I mean, one could say maybe among the Protestants themselves, where you may have different groups, that it may be similar. You know, but the difference between Catholic and Protestant is more like the difference between mainstream Sunni Islam and Shia Islam.
Thank you. We have another question.
Yes, I believe the Islamic religion teaches us that there's only one true God. Yes, I also want to know if it strongly promotes peace and love. As we see, there's so much unrest in the world. I was just wondering, does it also strongly promote peace and love?
Exactly, because actually Islam itself, linguistically, coming from salam means peace. When Muslims greet each other and greet others, they say salam alaikum. I'm sure you've heard that many times. Salam means peace be on you, which is the same greeting Jesus used to give to his companions, etc. So Islam really is about peace. It seeks peace, it wants peace, and it flourishes in times of peace. Though there is a tendency in the media to promote the idea that it is a product of conflict, that it likes fighting, you know, that you know, jihad and terrorism and things, these seem to be more associated with Islam through the media, but the true picture is quite different from that. Islam spread to, for example, Indonesia, the largest Muslim country in the world today, you know, close to 200 plus million Muslims, and there was not a single soldier who set foot on the shores of Indonesia. It all spread through trade. So Islam is not really about war, but Muslims, you may find Muslims in different points of conflict around the world because of a desire to self-determination. You know, what you find when you go and look at the essence of all of the struggles, whether it is Palestine, whether it is Chechnya, whether it is Algeria, etc., you find at the root of it if you remove the propaganda and just get to the root, what are these people actually fighting about? You'll find that it is a desire for self-determination, that Islam should govern their lives. You know, they should have the right to let Islam be the force, major force in their lives.
Okay. Well, if we could, go ahead.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. My question is this, ke most modern Arabic and the Arabic written in the Quran is the same or not? We Pakistanis, we reading Quran regularly but not understanding Arabic properly. So this Arabic and Quran Arabic is the same?
Okay, the spoken Arabic, you know, we have what is maybe called slang, you know, which is what is spoken here, as in other parts of the Arab world, there will be different slangs. But everybody who is Arab, when they go through school, they will learn formal, proper Arabic. So they'll be able to understand it, and this is what, for example, is used, you know, in television broadcasts of news, etc., etc. That will be the classical standard Arabic. But what is spoken locally amongst people will tend to be, you know, according to different dialects or slangs.
He will have a general understanding of the meaning of that particular verse. But for its explanation, I mean, you have scholars who write books, 30, 40 books in explanation of Holy Quran. So you cannot expect an ordinary person to understand all that just by directly reading. Yes, yet
so it seems to be little different Quran language.
Yet you see people from.
Yeah. Why not this is an Islamic government. Why not they open some schools here? The people will learn Arabic and understand Quran.
Well, Dr. Bilal is holding his own courses in Arabic language. And I think he have them. He does a 3 months course in Arabic, and there are other different associations and schools and colleges here which are offering learning Arabic. You can look at the classifieds if you'd like.
No, why not the government opening some free school to people come and learn? But no, most of the people they open Arabic school here, they charge money, and most of the people, they are poor and they have less salary. They wanted to learn Arabic.
Okay, at the, you know, I'm the director of an Islamic center in Karama.
Yeah, I've gone to your school, I'm your student.
Yes. Uh-huh.
I've gone to your school, but still, because the course in Ramzan was only for 1 month. And after that finished in Karama?
Not normally. The course is a 2.5 to 3 month course, and it is available to the general public, and it's geared towards working people, and it's got a very, you know, small fee for entrance. And there are other societies around that are holding courses like that. For example, I live in Ajman, and there are centers there where they do provide Arabic for men and for women.
Thank you, Dr. Bilal. One more question.
Assalamu alaikum. I had a little question for you, Dr. Bilal. I wanted to know, I assume that you were not born as a Muslim, but I wanted to know what made you think to change your religion? I mean, there was some breakpoint probably somewhere that made you think. I mean, changing religion is not an easy thing, I understand that, but there is a break point where you decided to change your religion, and I wanted to know what is that, where is that period, what was the incident?
Especially for a Jamaican, Dr. Bilal.
Why especially for a Jamaican? myself, let me say that, to be honest, when I was in university in Canada, I grew up in Canada, I had basically left Christianity. I became involved in student politics, and you know, the favorite line of politics then was communism, communist thought. So I had embraced communism and became a propagator of Marxist-Leninism for a number of years, actually. And after becoming disenchanted with it, seeing that it really was not leading anywhere, it really didn't change individuals. There were a lot of beautiful slogans, but the individuals who were involved were not themselves changed people. You know, people would always say, after the revolution, you know, this will happen and that will happen. So I felt, I mean, there needed to be something which directed a person to individual change. So in my search, you know, as a communist, you know, looking for something beyond communism, I stumbled on Islam, you know, and it really intrigued me. I read about it, and what I found there was that the good things that communism seemed to be calling for were there. The good things which were in capitalism were there. The good things which were from my background as a Christian were there. So it seemed to me that Islam had it all. It was a complete way of life. So this is what really attracted me. And it said, if the whole world doesn't change, you have to change, because you are responsible before God.
Well, that's all the time we have for now. I'd like to thank our panel for joining us, and thank you to our audience. See you next time with more on Open Doors, Open Minds. Thank you.